السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح
Just before we start, whoever owns that Subaru that's parked block in the post office, if I can please ask you to move it. We're trying to keep a good name in the Muslim community and we don't want to be a burden on anybody, inshallah. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My brothers and sisters in Islam, I've chosen a beautiful topic today. I was watching something the other day and something hit me really hard. Some of us in school, we learn about this line. This line is called the timeline. For the ones who don't know what a timeline is, it's either a time telling you what the time is, in what country, or your time on this earth. I'd like to start off every khutbah first and foremost, reminding us all to say Alhamdulillah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala akram alayna and allowed us to live for another Jum'ah. Because on the day of Jum'ah, the Malaika stand on each and every single dua of Allah, writing down each and every single name of each and every single brother that attended in the name of Allah Azza wa Jal. And that book is then closed when the call of Adhan is called. And that book is taken to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So on that note, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the ones of that book, inshallah. My brothers, you can all see I've got a rope in my hands. And if I can get your attention, and no, I'm not here to commit suicide. This rope, I want you to imagine, goes forever. Forever and ever. It just doesn't end. I want you to imagine that this rope I've got in my hand is your timeline. This part goes on forever. It doesn't finish. But this part is your existence in this dunya. Now I want everybody to comprehend this just for 1 minute. From here onwards is eternity. But this little part right here, and I'm hoping you can all see this, is your time existence in this dunya. And it just blows me away. It blows me away how many of us seem to focus primarily only on this time. But yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us, life doesn't end here. It goes on, and on, and on, and on, and on. And again, I want you to imagine this rope just doesn't end, it just keeps going. Now taking that into consideration, why is it a majority of us seem to think that life is here? Or the funniest part, are the ones that think, if I work really hard from here to here, then I can really enjoy here. Brothers and sisters in Islam, there's two problems here. First of all, why would you want to enjoy here when there's all here? And why do you want to sacrifice all your life and all your energy and all your focus? So don't misinterpret my words. I'm not saying don't go enjoy life. But I'm talking about your focus. Why is it, let me burn all my focus here, all my energy, all my time. Work, save. And then when I get to here, I'm going to enjoy it. Who wants to enjoy here when there's here? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told you and I that there's eternity forever. And then for the ones who think that I'll enjoy this part, have you not heard of Malik al-Maut? Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un? Did He not say every soul shall taste death? Brothers and sisters, in any of those sentences, where does He mention when you get to here? Because no one in this room, including myself, can guarantee you'll even get to here to enjoy it. So why is our focus to burn all of this, be assumed in all of this, be consumed in all of this, be indulged in all of this, when it's going to end? And the reality of it is, whatever you do here will determine where you go here. Subhanallah, such a simple experiment, but it's reality. Why has shaitan tricked you and I to believe that this part is the most important part for us? This is where my focus should be. This is where my time should be. This is where my energy should be. I need to build. I need to save. I need to do. I need to consume everything into this. Brothers, on my rope, it's only 5 centimeters. In dunya, it's actually shorter. But I wanted to make it a little bit longer for the ones that are sitting at the back, they can see. My brothers and sisters in Islam, don't let shaitan delude you. Because I'm yet to meet anybody that told me they live past this stage. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He even says to us in the Quran, so we don't get tricked. So when we go to Him on that day, the day when He says, Malik yawm al-Din, He's the king of that day, the day where there's no excuses, He tells you about dunya, so you don't say, I didn't know. If I knew, I would have cut my time. I would have focused more. Allah tells you in chapter 40, in Surah Ghafoor, He says, O my people. Allah says, O my people. Truly, this life of this world is nothing but an enjoyment. And verily, the hereafter, that is the home that you remain in forever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you in the Quran that the hereafter is what? It's forever. Meaning, this is a quick passing. Now if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already told us this, what's going to be my excuse and your excuse when we get to Allah and say, Ya Allah, You didn't give me enough time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you, and I've said this in my khutbahs previously, I created jinn kind and mankind only to worship me. I'm not telling you to enjoy quality time with your wife and children. I'm not telling you to have a hobby. I'm not telling you to do all of that. But I'm telling you, where are you consuming the majority of your time and your focus? And have you done enough so when eternity starts, you can go somewhere that you want to go? Because there's no ticket. You can't go onto Google and buy this ticket. The only way to do this is disconnect your heart with the dunya. This is the truth. How do we know this? Because the most finest man, the most finest man to come down to this earth, he led by example with this. This man, what was his name? His name was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And a lot of people know this beautiful hadith. The hadith about when Umar radiallahu anhu enters the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's room for the first time. He enters his room for the first time and he looks around. Obviously, if you and I are going to enter the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's room, we're going to be intrigued. We're going to know, what has he got? What does he have? What does he do? And when he looks around, he is absolutely shocked. Who's shocked, brothers? Amr radiallahu anhu. Who's Amr? Amr is the one that traveled to kill Rasulullah. Amr is the one that fought in so many battles and he cried so much that his face would mark from his tears because he was scared that he hasn't done enough for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Amr is the one that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if there was to be a prophet after me, oh Amr, it would be you. Amr was so feared that when the enemy knew that he was coming in battle, their knees would shake. Amr was feared so much even by the unseen, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, oh Amr, each road you take, they part ways. That man that none of us can ever reach his caliber dropped to the ground and started crying. He started crying and he says, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responds, what's wrong, O Amr? He says, Ya Rasulullah, the emperors and the kings and the leaders are living in castles and eating out of gold and sleeping on satin and even pearls, and you are between four clay walls and sleeping on the floor, Ya Rasulullah, when you are the ruler. And he keeps crying. Crying because he realized that our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had nothing. Four walls of clay. Now listen to the response of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because it's a beautiful response. He looked up at Amr radiallahu anhu with a smile. He looked up at Amr radiallahu anhu with a beautiful smile. And he said, oh Amr, oh Amr, is it not enough for us that for us is the hereafter and for them in this world is only this world? Meaning what? What's it meaning, brothers? Meaning for them is here. There's no here. Ya Ami, what do we want? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Even he led by example. He never wore silk. He never had the fancy stuff that we have. He never wore gold. He didn't have castles. But now, let's talk about now just for 1 minute on this timeline. Now a brother goes to Marshall Mercedes, he finances his first AMG. Or he becomes to be known as the known drug dealer in the area. Or a gangster. Step back. Khalas, you can't speak to him unless you're on his caliber. Whether you're Muslim, non-Muslim, it doesn't matter. Unless you're dressed in Gucci and you've got an AMG like him, and you've got an army behind you, he doesn't want to give you the time of day. Why? Because he thinks his timeline is going to last forever. When the most righteous, the most beautiful, the most humble men on this earth had nothing, and they used to travel far and beyond to come and meet this man. Let's compare the way they act and the way he acts. They used to travel far and beyond to come and meet this man that they call Rasulullah. And they couldn't even tell who he was. No one could tell who he was. Why? Because he dressed like everyone else. He spoke like everyone else. And he ate with everyone else. Nothing about him made him any more superior than anyone else around him. Now ask yourselves, brothers and sisters, was he attached? Did he want this part? Was he focused on this part? Please move forward, brothers, so we can allow more people in, inshallah. If the most righteous man that ever came to this earth, if the most righteous man ever came to this earth, wasn't attached to this. When all the wealth of the world was between his hands. When all the castles, all the houses, all the jewelry, everything was in his hands at this time. And even him, he was not interested in this part of his timeline. He didn't want it. What did he want? He wanted this. Now ask yourself, brothers and sisters, you can tell me all you want after this khutbah finishes, that I don't want this. But actions speak louder than words. I've said it before and I'll say it again. You're the author to your own book, Yawm al-Qiyamah. Now when your book is read, is it going to be read that your timeline on this earth, this short time, was consumed in dunya, or was your primary focus on the afterlife? بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. My brothers and sisters in Islam, Wallah forgive me. But sometimes you gotta stand in front of the mirror and just give yourself a bit of a reality check. And ask yourself, like honestly ask yourself, what do I want? Because if you believe in Allah, you believe in the afterlife. And if you believe in the afterlife, you believe that there's either Jannah or Jahannam. And you're either going to go here or here. There's no middle. And the only thing that will determine that is not what badge you've got on your Mercedes. Not the size of your house and not your bank balance. It's what you've done in this short time. That's it. And what's funny is many brothers come to me and many sisters come to me and say, it's hard. Other people are enjoying that. I want happiness. It's hard. I say to them, I've heard many times, In many ahadith, no matter how hard this dunya is, no matter how hard, one dip in Jannah, and you will forget every single hardship you went through in this dunya. One second dip. And for the ones that are too submerged and focused, that life ends at this dunya, and I'm going to do everything in my power to build houses and banks and rob people and sell drugs and go into riba and do everything that Allah doesn't tell me to do to get my ticket to Jannah, and think that I'm enjoying it, and think that this is life and such is life. By Allah, one dip in Jahannam and you are going to forget every single bit of enjoyment you had in this short life. My brothers and sisters in Islam, there is a beautiful lollipop, a sweetener, that I'm going to share with you today. Inshallah, this will be your primary focus to work. Every one of us say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. You go to Medina and you see everybody crying because they love Rasulullah. And anytime someone shares a hadith about Rasulullah, there's not a dry tear, not a dry eye in the room. Saying that, is it not worth wasting your timeline, focusing your timeline, so you can be with the one they call Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Just imagine for 1 minute, let's comprehend this. Imagine being in the highest of Jannah, and one of your wishes is to meet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in that short timeline, you have done enough work in this timeline, enough work in this little bit, that you've earned the right to walk up to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and shake his hand and say, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Ya Rasulullah. I love you, Ya Rasulullah. And hug him and tell him, I read so much about you, I heard so much about you. And then just stand back and ponder and admire this man, and then go, I earned this. I spent my timeline working hard to sit with this beautiful man. I'm going to enjoy this life now, because this life on your timeline now, it goes forever. There's no end. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to make this beautiful dua amongst many to detach his life and his heart and his soul to dunya. So now I'm going to share this dua with you, inshallah, hoping that we will, inshallah, use this. Whenever the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say something beautiful, he used to say, La Aisha, La Aisha al-Akhirah. He used to say, there's no true life besides the afterlife. There's no true life. He'd remind himself, there's no true life and there's no life besides the afterlife. Because this life, look brothers, it ends. So today I gave you and me the wake-up call. I allowed you to remove shaitan from your ears and take a dose of reality that your tape, now don't think that your tape's going to end here. My tape could end here. Your tape could end here and your tape could end here. Only Allah knows. In saying that, ask yourself, have you done in your timeline to be in Jannah forever? Because brothers and sisters in Islam, the only haqq after Malik al-Mawt comes and takes your soul is Yawm al-Qiyamah and Jannah or Jahannam. No solicitor, no barrister, no QC, no nobody is going to help you. On that note, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the ones that their eternity is where? In Jannah. Inna Allah wa malaikatu yusalluna ala nabi. يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما كثيرا اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد وبارك على محمد وعلى محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, the most forgiving, and also the harshest of punishers, to forgive us and open our hearts to the Akhirah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty and the most forgiving, to only attach our dunya to Jannat al-Firdaus. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove all pride from our hearts, because pride is the disease that attaches us to thinking that this world is important. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us all if we got it wrong so far. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us inside our heart, inside our soul, to only love His deen. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us and protect us. And we ask Allah to have mercy on us yawm al-qiyamah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to punish the oppressors in this dunya and the akhirah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lower the oppressors into the lowest pit of Jahannam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect the Muslims wherever they're getting oppressed and picked on, in places like Lebanon and Palestine and Syria and Afghanistan. And I could sit here now and go on so many countries, but we don't have all day to talk about all the Muslims that are getting oppressed. My brothers and sisters in Islam, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to only attach you to the Akhirah, because the only life is the Akhirah, and this life is a test to determine where you're going to end up. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhiratu hasana wa qina adhab an-nar wa aqim as-salat.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله